announced on last Sunday, our theme this year is the eve of something great. And so what I want you all to understand is that there is an atmosphere of greatness happening, not only here at this church, but in this country. There is an atmosphere of greatness happening in you individually as well. And so in our text on today, it's apparent that greatness is happening all over God's people. And I just believe that he's the same God yesterday and today and forevermore, that the same God that was doing great things back then has to be doing great things right now. Amen, amen. So in our text, it's obvious that God's people and the kingdom of God, they're at the eve of greatness. And truth be told, we are always at the eve of greatness. In fact, each of us is a candidate by grace for the greatness of God. And each of us has an opportunity to experience great things in God's sight. And if you just look at the person next to you, you don't have to look them up, down, up and down too hard. But if you just look at them, you're looking at greatness. Everybody do the selfie thing where you want to take a selfie and say, I'm all that. But if you just take the time and not be selfish for one time and look, maybe it's the person to the right don't look too appealing. Look to your left there. See, that's greatness right there to your left. Amen. Amen. Listen, so in our text today, I want to take our text from the gospel according to, and I just love that graphic. I love that graphic. Even something great. Look at our text, the gospel according to Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 37. I'm going to read about 11 or so verses, and I want to preach from the same theme that we had on last week, which was the eve of something great, part 2. But I've got a little subtitle, and you'll see what I'm talking about in just a few moments. But from the NIV version, the NIV version of Luke chapter 1, verse 26 begins, in the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, who was a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. Verse 34 says, how will this be? Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be barren, is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God. Go on to verse, is there verse 38 in your NIV? Look at that. It says, I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. So may it be to me as you have said. Then the angel left her. I want to speak just for a few moments from the subtopic, God is still choosing vessels to birth greatness. God still using vessels to birth greatness. Last week, you recall, Zechariah was performing his priestly duties in the temple. He was burning incense, and while he was burning incense, the people were praying. And as the people were praying, they were all praying on one accord. And the Bible says that the angel Gabriel appears to Zechariah and lets him know that their prayers had been heard and answered. He says to Gabriel, Gabriel says to Zacharias, he says, number one, there's great news. The prayer that you've been sending up about the Messiah is on the way. But he says, I've got even greater news. You and Elizabeth are about to welcome a baby boy, a son called Jonah. In other words, he says, I've got two bits of great news for you. What you've been praying for and what your people have been praying for all these years is about to come. Messiah is on his way. But then I also want you to know that you're about to have a son. And you may not see the connection. Here's the connection. Your son's sole purpose is to make easy the path, to warm up the heart, to prepare the people for the coming Messiah.
Yes.
Your son will come out first, and he'll be a part of kingdom greatness. He will be the one who welcomes the heart and the minds, and prepares the hearts and minds of people to receive the Messiah. And just like we noted on last week, the best preparation when you are getting ready for something great in your life, the best preparation you and I can do is, number one, to be found praying.
Yeah.
Talk about that on last week. We said if you're at the cusp, if you're at the edge, if you're at the eve, if you would, of greatness, then the best thing for you to do is not walk around and wait on it, but you need to be found praying to God.
Yeah.
That's why the Bible says that they were found praying in the temple. This was regular prayer. It was the same prayer. God had been silent in writing for 400 plus years, and here it is now. God was getting ready to break his silence because the people had consistently been found praying. But then number one, yeah, we need to be found praying, but number two, we need to expect our prayers to be answered. He says, not only is it not enough just to say a prayer or to say something, just to give some lip language to God, but to actually believe and expect that what you ask God for, you expect God to answer your prayers. He says, number one, we need to be found praying. Number two, last week we talked about that we need to expect God to answer. Then we say number three, we have to be open to the fact that God can do with impossibilities and make everything possible, even with the impossible. So that even when you and I have written it off and say there's no way out, there's no way in, there's no way around, no way up, no way down, no way out of this situation, that even in the most impossible situation, God is able to be a God of possibilities. One, we need to be found praying. Two, we need to expect an answer. Number three, we need to be open to God doing the impossible in our lives. And then finally, we got to wait on God to work in his own way and in his own time. You can't, as the song said, you can't hurry God. You just got to wait. You got to trust him and give him time, no matter how long it takes. He says, God, you can't hurry. He'll be there if you don't worry. May not come when you want him, but he's right on time. That when I turn it over to Jesus and when I turn it over into God's hands, that I'm expecting him to answer in his own way and in his own time. But that was last week when we talked about John and Zechariah. This week we put our attention on Mary, and not so much Mary, but Mary being a vessel to what God is getting ready to do for the Messiah. The conversation that we're allowed to peek into says that, yes, there's a vessel in the midst of us. And that's the things I learned about vessels. You recall when I had all these pots up here on the stage, they were all vessels for God's use. And vessels come in all sizes and shapes. There's some glass vessels that are very fragile. There's some gold vessels that are very precious. There's some brass vessels that are very sturdy and hard. There's some wooden vessels that serve the purpose that it serves. And just like there are a variety of vessels that we know of as objects, there are a variety of vessels that God uses in the church today. And you look around and you look at people, they may not look like it, but they are all, and we are all, vessels of some sort and some kind.
Yeah.
There are some people that are like glass vessels. They're real pretty and transparent, but if you drop them or have them the wrong way, they'll break all the pieces. But that doesn't mean that they're not a good vessel. There are some people that say that they're golden vessels, but really what they are is the shiny brass. They're just trying to make you think they all that and then some. But they're golden or they're brass, but nonetheless they serve their purpose. They're the wooden vessels that have been chipped along the way, that have holes in them and they're leaky, but yet they serve the purpose that God has for them. And we really are all vessels waiting for God to do something great through us.
Yeah.
Look at the text, and I realized that the vessel that were being used was Mary. She was a chosen vessel. She was a vehicle that was going to deliver the Messiah according to the prophecies that were written 100 years ago before they even got to this text. But somehow or another, the right location, the right time, time. In other words, there's some things that you want to see happening in your life, and you feel like it's the right location. But God is saying it may not be the right timing right now. You might even think this is the right vessel, but it's just not the right location or the right time. But when the right time and the right location and the right vessel lines up, then God is able to usher in greatness in our lives.
Yeah.
I learned some things about being a vessel, and that's what I want to talk about, because God is still using vessels to bring about greatness in this world.
Yeah.
He's still using vessels like you and me, and I know you may think, I'm not all that, I'm a working prophet, but you're a vessel nonetheless that God can use, and there's no big vessels and little vessels or precious vessels or unprecious vessels. We're all vessels in God's sight. But here's the question. How do I know if I'm really fit to be a vessel for greatness?
Yes.
Because folks can carry around a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
If you're a vessel, you can carry pretty much anything that you can hold inside your soul. That's why you find that some vessels were really meant to carry one thing, but they carry another thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do. Okay, let me tell you about it. On my job. I talk about my folks on my job, but this is what it is. You talk about folks on your job too. There are vessels in my department that carry things and bring things to the manager's attention.
All right.
And what I have to remind them is, you are bigger than this. You were meant and designed and purposed to carry much more than gossip. You were meant to carry the gospel. And so when people bring things to me that they're not supposed to be carrying, the first thing I let them know is, I need you to get that out outside my door. Because when you bring me stuff and you expect me to react stuff that you brought me, but you were never intended to carry that kind of stuff anyway, because as a vessel, you were designed for bigger than that. Then it reminds me of what God is doing in our lives daily. There's some people that have been empty vessels that God has been waiting to use, and you and I need to take inventory of what God is doing and how God has purposed us, because I just believe that if all of us carry what God asked us to carry, then this world will be a better. Mary's conversation as Luke details it. And I said, here's a woman of God that realized that she was a vessel in the making for carrying something great. First thing I realized that the prerequisite for being a vessel of greatness is that you gotta be, number one, ordinary. Ordinary. In other words, you gotta be somebody who everybody sing the praises of, you just gotta be an ordinary person.
Yeah.
Here was a teenager, but the Lord was with her. How do I know? When you look at verse 28, verse 28 says to us, it says that the virgin's name was Mary. And verse 28 says, the angel went to her and said, greetings, you are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Yeah. In other words, what he says is, he lets them know that I don't have to be extraordinary. I don't have to have super special or talented gifts. I don't have to be highly educated. I don't have to be exceptionally gifted. But all I need to do is to have a relationship with God.
Yeah.
An ordinary person having a relationship with an extraordinary God.
Yeah.
Makes up for my shortcomings. Makes up for my lack, if you would. So God is still looking for ordinary folks to carry out extraordinary things.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. I need us to understand. If you recognize that you're ordinary and open yourself to an extraordinary God, if I recognize I'm just a regular old Baptist minister, God, who's extraordinary, can use an ordinary Baptist minister to carry the gospel. Our church, if you go up to New York City and stop 12 people on the street and ask if they've heard of Covenant Street Baptist Church, chances are they'll say no. Because what? Covenant Street is an
Yeah.
But watch this. When ordinary people and ordinary churches open themselves up to an extraordinary God, then God is able to use vessels like us to do great things. Oh my God. I kept reading. I said, there it is, first of all, that you got to be ordinary. So God uses ordinary people and things. But then here's the second prerequisite for a vessel of greatness. You got to not only be ordinary, but you got to be undeserving. I know we think that we should be better off than what we are right now, but truth be told, it's by God's grace and His mercy and His favor that I got what I got right now. You got to be undeserving. I read in a text from verse 30. If you would, verse 30 says, I got a volume of a text here, it says that, but the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Let me tell you something. Favor makes up for what education can't give. Favor makes up for what connections don't have. If you got favor from God, it says, I'm undeserved. But somehow or another, God chooses me to have favor over my life. I kept reading, I said, that's what Mary says. Mary says, she says, you found favor in God's sight. She said, first place, she says, what? Can you imagine going through her mind? This is the same thing we be saying. There's some more people more qualified than I am. God, I'm not prepared. Don't have the education. Don't have the experience. And as long as he's going through my mind, thinking of all these things like, I'm not ready, I don't know what I'm doing, then the Holy Spirit speaks through the angel again and says, you don't have to worry about how you do it, why you do it. All you need to know is that the favor of God is on your life.
Yeah.
What he says is, basically, she says, well, how can it be? How in the world is this going to happen? He says, that's why the Holy Spirit is going to overshadow you and cover your weakness.
Yeah.
The same Holy Spirit power is the same context that they used in the beginning, where it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the Spirit of God hovered above, over the deep. In other words, what he says is, God's Spirit will overshadow even emptiness and bring about in your life. Areas that you had no control, areas that you had no training, God is saying, I'm just going to take somebody ordinary and undeserving, and I'm going to put favor over their life.
Yeah.
It's true. Apart from God's Spirit, we really can't do nothing.
Amen. Amen.
I know I said it. I know I put double negatives against English majors, but I did it for the flavor of it. I know this isn't doing anything, but I'm just going to break it down. We can't do nothing without God's Spirit in our lives. So here's the truth. When you recognize that you're undeserving, when I recognize I'm undeserving, and when we as a church recognize that we really shouldn't be at this location, in this city, at this particular time, when we realize we're undeserving, then God says, I'm going to give you favor. They still shouldn't be at that location. They should have closed their doors by now.
Yeah.
She still should be on that job.
Yeah.
She ain't gonna keep that manager position long.
Right.
They really shouldn't be married. Truth be told, that was mine anyway. But what David says, God overlooked all of the inconsistencies, all of the shortcomings, all of the backbite, all of the negativity, all of the haters, and he said, come on, God, I can do whatever I want to, favor over there, God.
Yeah.
So, one, you gotta be ordinary. Number two, you gotta be undeserving. But then here's the other thing. This was part of what the church starts walking out and coming to the ears, because they don't want to hear this part, but you gotta be pure.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, I know I'm a red light, man. You don't know what that word means down there. As long as it's 99%, you know, I have a soul, then it's pure. But
yeah.
to make a cake that somebody's making for you. To make it poisonous.
Oh, man.
Take one drop. So when you get through, either you 100% or you're not at all. But God chose a vessel that was pure. And it was when she said, how can this be since I'm a virgin? That messed me up because I'm thinking to myself, is she saying that purity cannot welcome in the Messiah? But what she was saying is, how can I bring forth a child if I've never been with a man? Oh, But what she says is, because I've never been touched in my bathing suit area, that a boat is going to come through this womb. But here's the thing that God woke me up this morning. He said, her purity is exactly the womb that I needed for the birth of my son.
Preacher!
No mistake, if you recognize your purity, and I recognize my purity, my walk, my lifestyle, my livelihood, my words, my actions, and if the church recognizes its purity, then it becomes fertile ground for greatness.
Yes, sir.
We're undeserving. If we're pure, and if we are ordinary. But here's another prerequisite I found, is that you gotta be spirit-filled.
Yeah.
Verse 35 says, the angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Yeah. Good God Almighty. What he's basically saying is, this ain't no natural phenomenon that's about to happen in your life. No, you all want some supernatural stuff, adventures and all that. I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about the fact that we gotta recognize what we see down here is the natural. But there's a supernatural realm at work above us and around us that we have no knowledge of what God is keeping us from. And the danger seen and unseen is in the supernatural realm. Yeah, I know you thought it was somebody driving crazy on the expressway, but what he didn't show you was that there was a demonic assignment on your life to use whoever he wanted to use to take you down. But God says, I'm going to use some undeserving force, and I'm going to put my man. Never before in our lives, and I just really feel like we, as a body of Christ, I feel like the church, and I feel like individuals are on the eve of something great in your life. I don't know what it is, because greatness is defined in several ways. For somebody, greatness will be just being able to pay my bills at the end of the year. That's a great thing in my life. For somebody else, greatness will be for this relationship that they're in that's failing and has been failing for years. And be reconciled. In other words, that would be greatness. Somebody else said, greatness would be if my son and my daughter, who's out there on the streets, came home, gave their life to Christ, and started living their lives upright. Somebody else defines greatness as one thing, but I'm just letting you know, God is getting ready to do some great things in your life.
Yeah.
Keep reading. The last thing I realized was that God says that the prerequisite is that I need to find some ordinary people who are undeserving of my favor, who are pure and spirit-filled. But then the last text says in verse 37, actually verse 35, he says, the Holy Spirit will come on you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called Son of God. He says, even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who is said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail.
Yes.
I kept reading. I said, okay, wait a minute. He's telling her, a woman that she's not even seen, that she's related to, a woman who the world says she was married, but God says she's about to give birth. Mm-hmm. You got to be careful of what the world says.
Yeah.
And listen to what God says.
Yeah.
When you get through labeling me and get through running my prescription and my prophecy, then I gotta go to God and say, God, I know what they say, but what do you say?
Yeah.
Just somebody say, what does God say?
No.
what so-and-so church is doing. So-and-so is doing this. This church over here, they moving and shaking. They doing this, this. And they wait on my reaction to see if I'm going to say something negative. Because if you ain't been positive, you can always find something negative to say.
Yeah.
They're not going to say, you know over there, down there, so-and-so. You know that a lot of members joining down there. But they do with X, Y, and Z. And they wait for my reaction. Change brings about discomfort. Discomfort brings about observant.
Yeah.
I gotta be ordinary.
Yeah.
I gotta be pure. I gotta be led by the Spirit. In other words, I got to understand that it's not just me, but because I'm tied to a body of Christ, and because I'm also tied to this church, everything that I do impacts the greatness of the other. Here it is. Mary, if she had aborted her child, would have impacted not only her family, not only herself, but she would have impacted not only that, but the world that we live in today.
Yeah.
If she had aborted what greatness was in her, if she had given up on the greatness or chosen not to be a recipient or a vessel of the greatness, then she would have affected everything that she was connected to for generations to come. I say that because this, we want to be, Common Street, a vessel of greatness.
Yeah.
Then it starts with us being people and vessels of greatness. Yeah. I just kept off talking about it because guess what? Here's reality. I told you everybody wants greatness,
yeah,
but they don't want to go through what it takes to get greatness. See, greatness don't just walk around and just overtake you just for, no, greatness has to be set up. I told you the prerequisites. In other words, God's looking for something that's pure. God's looking for something undeserved. So there's a lot that needs to be cleared out in your personal life in order for you to be a recipient of greatness. But if we can ever get to the point, for you,
yeah,
and you,
yeah,
you, and you decide that I'm ordinary, undeserving,
yes,
pure, Spirit-filled, and I'm available, then we'll see not only greatness in your life, but in the life of the church.
Amen.
God still uses them.
Yeah.
He still uses them. Vessels.
Yeah.
To birth greatness. Mm-hmm. And you and I come to that realization. We'll see not only the church, but we'll see the impact that the church has upon this city and this nation.
Yeah.
So here's my prayer. Here's my prayer for 2018. It's one of my prayers for 2018. Is that God's people will become more aligned to His purpose. More aligned to His will. So that as we become more aligned to His purpose and His will, that God's church will impact this city and this nation and this world like never before.
Yeah.
That's my prayer. That's my prayer. And here's my prayer. My prayer affects not only the church, it affects you and it affects me as well, because all of us have to be ready to be inconvenienced and be ready to take on an agenda that we didn't have plans for.
Yeah.
Be ready to embrace change. All of us have to be ready to be discomforted for a little while. It may be 9 months, it might be 9 years, it might be 9 days, but we got, in order for us to carry greatness, we got to carry it in such a way that we are discomforted, that our agenda is jacked up and thrown into haywire. But all of us gonna work out because God says, I'm birthing greatness through somebody. Are you a vessel? Or are you just a pitcher? A container? Are you a vessel? Containers hold things. Vessels carry things. And you know if you're a container Christian or straight up bona fide vessel, in what you have in you, you carry everywhere you go. God says, I want some vessels. Today's invitation is just that. If you're in a place and you decide, you know what? I've been a container all my life. I'm ready to be a vessel for God. To birth greatness, then we need to see you on today.